everyone, to another episode of the VOZ segment on Due to Knowledge Radio. I'm your host, More Kananya. I want to first give all praises to the Holy One of Israel, to his anointed leadership, and all his messianic sainthood. I greet everyone in a perfect peace and love. Shalom, shalom. We have a very important show this evening for the family. If you were listening to the prelude, you were listening to Ami, the Veggie Man, and Dana. The song is entitled Rising Up. You can listen to more from Ami's music by logging into www.theveggieman.net. He has some great music, so check that out. I want to preface this particular show, or should I say set the table, because we have extravagant cuisine that we're serving up this evening. We have the head priest from the Prophetic Priesthood, Rahvyah Ben Eliazar, presenting the Spiritual Significance of Passover and Redefining the Ritual. This is such a timely event as Passover is just around the corner as we approach the new year, the season of Aviv. But not only is this timely event, but a prophetic one. What we're doing this evening is historical and monumental. In this sense, we have a teaching priest on the line this evening and live from the land of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov, from the foothills of Judea, is about to teach us a class on one of the most sacred holy days, Pesach. I just want to go over, I want to hit a scripture before we get into it. I want to go into Isaiah, the second chapter. It says, the word Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw. This is what Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of mountains, and it shall be exalted above the hills, and all the nations shall flow unto it. And many people shall go and say, come ye and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. And he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his path. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of Yah from Jerusalem. Surely, our King, we are in the last days as we watch the great mountain Babylon be made low due to its iniquities. This is why I chose to title The Voice of Zion, as this platform is simply helping play out the prophetic utterance spoken by the great prophet Isaiah as he prophesies about the end time, stating, for out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of Yah from Jerusalem. Tonight, family, you will indeed hear the word of Yah spoken by the high priest of the prophetic priesthood, Rahvyah Ben Eliazar. So I want to welcome everyone again to the show. Please pay close attention and enjoy the class. But before we go any further, like all events concerning the sons and daughters of Yah, we must begin in prayer. So we're going to have the mighty Hebrew open us up in prayer, and then we're going to have Ak Ben Kayo raise the ark and continue to set the table and eventually bring on the priests. So shalom, shalom, our king. Hello?
Shalom, Ak. They haven't joined us yet.
Okay. No problem. We'll wait for the rest of the family to get on. Priest, are you on?
Shalom, I'm on.
Shalom. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, we welcome you on the VOZ segment. We're very, very, very thankful for you to come on.
Shalom, shalom, I'm on. Mighty Hebrew.
Kane. So, Mighty Hebrew, let's open up in prayer and let's proceed on.
Yes, sir.
Am I on? Am I on? Kane,
yes, you're Kane. On. Go ahead.
Kane.
Okay.
You say you want to open up in prayer?
Go ahead, Mighty Hebrew.
Open up. Okay. Hallelujah. 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 O great and eternal King, Supreme Master of the multiverse in this universe, we, B'nai Yisrael, coming to thee, humble and submissive, first and foremost, asking if it pleases you to approach your throne in righteousness. Tudor Rabbi Yah, for waking us up to see another day. We thank you, O great and eternal King, for everything that you've done for us, and we ask you to continue to watch over us, guide us, and continue to lead us in your wisdom and in your truth, O Yah, eternal King. And we ask you, O great and eternal King, as we get the information that we're going to receive tonight, we ask you to bless Orah Kohane, to bring down your chakmah, your divine wisdom, and put in his mind to bring forth your Shekinah amongst us, your divine presence. And we thank you, Yah, blessing over this radio show, The Voice of Zion. I ask you to continue to bless over the family and the land, and I ask you to bless over the Israelites all over the four corners of the earth, and to keep us steadfast in this eternal idea of Hebrew Israelite sovereign nationalism. And we ask you, Yah, to give everybody on this radio show and those abroad the strength, the will, and the might to stand up for your awesome and mighty name, O Yah. For it is a new season, Yah. It is a new day, O great and eternal King. And we thank you, great and eternal King, and we praise and worship your awesome and mighty name. And we just thank you, O Yah, for giving us food, clothing, and shelter. We thank you for the things that we may have blindly not thanked you for. But we ask you, Yah, to forgive us if we didn't, you know, look towards that. And we just thank you for everything, Yah. And as the presentation goes on, we just ask you to shine forth knowledge into us. And with that, we say hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah,
Yahai, 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 Selah.
Shalom. Torah, by mighty Hebrew. Ben Kayo, can you raise the ark for us and bring on the priest? Bakasha.
All right. Knowledge, Takavo. Yahuwah Sivatai Tisakofi Yigi Tilatecha Kuma Yahuwah Vefutsu Yivecha Venusu Misanecha Mifanech Kuma Yahuwah Vefutsu Yivecha Venusu Misanecha Mifanech Kuma Yahuwah Vefutsu Yivecha Venusu Misanecha Mifanech Hallelujah. 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 Yochai. 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 Sing. Kono koko hakevoli yo yochwa kudosh Yisrael. Le aroneno rabbeno hamashiach. Kodishita sarah vatara vekokasida. Shalom, shalom. Greet everybody here in peace, or more accurately, in the Hebraic understanding of shalom and perfect wholeness and completeness. Tonight is, again, a very special episode for me. It's another person very dear to me. Now, when I was first making my switch over to remembering who I am as an Israelite, I was in the city of Indianapolis. I had managed to get my hands on a cassette tape of the Prophetic Priesthood. This was very crucial in me choosing which direction I was going to go. Mind you, after, you know, coming out of that world, after being so sick and tired of being sick and tired, I was trying to decide what I was going to do. I had got a hold to this tape, and the first selection from the cassette that I heard was a brother reading the dedication of the temple from Solomon. And immediately there was a resonance that linked with my soul. And actually, this tape kept me afloat until later that year. I was able to find the Saints in Chicago and move on out. Now, that voice was the brother that you're about to hear in a few minutes, Rahvyah Kohane. Now, when we talk about a teaching priest, we're talking about, when we look at the Valley of the Dry Bones, I'm viewing the priesthood, sort of like the sinews This brother here is not as you would envision a Catholic priest or something of that nature, where they just sit back in a sort of passive, reactive ceremonial role. Our priests are accessible every day in the midst of the people, teaching, guiding, and counseling. And this one right here is one of our very first. Brothers and sisters, please open your ears, open your hearts to receive the supplements that we require in this great, glorious season, this new beginning. Rahvyah Cohane.
Shalom, shalom.
Shalom.
Well, let me begin. Shalom. Let me begin by first giving all honor and praise to the source of our life, to the source of our being, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Giving all praise to your Yahuwah, to his anointed son, Ben-Ami, and then to all of those who are devoted and dedicated to the continual building and expansion of your Yahuwah's glorious kingdom, and who are devoted and committed to life-giving change on the face of this planet. In all humbleness of heart, I greet you all in eternal peace and love. Shalom Aleichem. As you've heard, my name is Rahvyah Ben Eliazar. I am privileged and blessed with the opportunity of being a servant of your Yahuwah in this kingdom, here in this great and holy land of ours, the land of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the land of Israel. And I am very, very thankful and very appreciative of the opportunity that has been extended to me, that has been extended to the prophetic priesthood this evening, to be able to come before you and to share with you the spiritual significance of Memorial Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, to share with you the spiritual significance of these glorious life-giving cycles that the Holy One of Israel has given unto us to assist us in our growth, evolution, and development as living souls on this planet. You see, we are very, very special people. And again, when you say that, that's not something that is expressed in arrogance. It's very humbling to realize that to be chosen and to be given the opportunity to understand the processes of life and how these processes can be applied in a way that will invigorate you, that will enliven you, and not just for you, but for you to be a light, to be an example, to be a way and means of expressing life where others will be able to look upon you and they too would be able to learn and understand what is required to live. And not to just live in the sense of being present, but to live in a way that is in harmony with the Creator and the creation, to bring balance, to bring peace, to bring stability, to bring joy, to bring those things that are essential to maintain the continual evolution and expression of life in everything that we do. Our Holy Father, Ben-Ami, in his first writing that he put forth entitled God, the Black Man, and Truth, one of the particular chapters in that book was entitled Cycles, Seasons, righteous cycles, seasons, and set times. And on page 186 and 187 of that particular book, God, the Black Man, and Truth, I extracted a excerpt that will assist us in understanding the principle and the spirit behind these life-giving cycles that has been given unto the house of Israel and truly given unto all of the human family for us to understand what is needed or what is required to enhance our ability to live. So, just want to read this particular excerpt into your hearing. And it's written as follows. Yahuwah has pre-established righteous cycles which control the elements, fire, air, water, and earth. These cycles also control the seasons of the cycles of birth and growth, joy and happiness, the renewing of the spirit, and spiritual elevation. An in-depth study of the cycles of life will render a deeper knowledge and understanding of the basic principles of life and the Creator, and how to use them to keep the world in a spirit of holiness. This spirit produces more holy thoughts, which form the ideas that produce actions, which are never contrary to the will and intention of the Creator. So here we are. Here we are. We're now in the third month in accordance with the Julian calendar. The holy day of Memorial Passover will take place in the fourth month of the Julian calendar. In accordance with the Hebrew calendar, the third and the fourth month is in alignment with the cycle of time that we identify as being the spring. The spring. In Hebrew, the spring is identified or is referred to as Aviv. Aviv. Spring. Aviv. A time and period that we all know that everything is anewed. Everything comes forth with new life, new expressions of life. We will begin to see the budding of the trees, floral growth on the limbs of the trees. We'll begin to see the trees turning green again. We'll begin to feel warmth once again coming in the air. As the winter fades away, the spring comes into being, we all witness new life. We see even in the creation, and we'll begin to see the animals beginning to mate, to bring forth new life and new life expressions on this planet. So it's really special to understand that here it is, Memorial Passover takes place in the time of the spring. Spring, new life, new beginning, renewal, invigoration, being enlivened. And then if we go to the scripture in the book of Exodus, the 12th chapter and the second verse, it reads, and this is again, this particular chapter gives us our intro into understanding how to celebrate and recognize this holy cycle of the Passover. The 12th chapter, the second verse reads, of the book of Exodus, it reads, "This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you." So here we see that Yahuwah instructed the ancients, instructed our fathers, and our mothers of ancient times, that this particular holy day would take place in the very first month of the year. So for us, we recognize that the ancient Hebraic month of Aviv is the beginning of the year, or what you could express in Hebrew being identified as Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah, the beginning of the year. The beginning of the year takes place in the ancient Hebraic month of Aviv. In modern Hebrew, Aviv is referred to as the month of Nisan. Nisan. However, we are not utilizing that particular term. We refer to the ancient Hebraic term of Aviv, which we know clearly to be, again, the spring. So, our Holy Father Benami revealed to us that these particular cycles, these righteous cycles, control the elements of fire, air, water, and earth. Well, that's what you and I are created of. That's what we're made of. Fire, which is spirit. Air, which we breathe. Oxygen. Water, we're 70% water. And earth, we are created from the dust of the earth. So these cycles control the very elements that we are created from. So as we go into these holy and sacred cycles, we begin to realize that they affect our very soul. They affect our very makeup and being as a living species, an expression of your Yahuwah on the face of this planet. And it's very important for us to continue to pursue to understand the greater spiritual significance of these cycles, because we're not recognizing them and celebrating them and applying them just out of a ritual acknowledgement. This is much more than a ritual. We are acknowledging them, and we are applying them and expressing them because we realize that they affect the very makeup of our soul. They affect the very essence of our being as human beings and expressions of Yah Yahuwah on this planet. So it's very, very important for us. So here we are. We're going into the spring. Rosh Hashanah, the new year. The Rosh Hashanah can also be translated, the word Rosh Hashanah can also be translated as the beginning of change. Shana comes from the, it has the root, or it's from the root word, or the root of the word, the Hebrew word, Shenui, Leshanot, change. Rosh Hashanah can also be identified as the focal point or the significant beginning point of life-giving change. So we want to go into the new year with our hearts open to experience higher understanding and consciousness that will allow for us to engage life giving change. This is very, very important for us to understand. This is not something that we're going into to just eat a good meal and to wear some new clothes and to say we celebrated the Passover. We want to go into this saying we have changed. We have evolved. We have ascended in our understanding of what is required of us to experience greater life-giving change, because it's affecting our very soul. It affects the elements, the earth, the wind, the water, the fire of our being. We are becoming more conscious. We are becoming more aware. We are becoming more astute of what is required of us to live. To live and to magnify the presence of our source of being, Yah Yahuwah, on the face of this planet, so that we can be living examples to assist others, to to understand what is required of them to live in harmony, in peace, in stability, in balance with one another and with all of creation on this planet. That is our calling. We are to be servants of life, servants that bring life to the creation. So this is, and we're preparing ourselves to go into the beginning of months, the head, the first month of the year, the Rosh Hashanah. And we want to open our hearts and open our minds to hear truth that will assist us to understand what is required of us to live, to make changes in our behavior, to make changes in our thinking, to make changes in our expressions that will allow us to live, to experience the beauty of this holy and sacred life that will be more vibrant, more invigorating, more peaceful, more joyful, causing us to be more thankful. So again, I go back to the Holy Father's excerpt out of God, the Black Man in Truth, and he said, an in-depth study of the cycles of life will render a deeper knowledge and understanding of the basic principles of life and the Creator and how to use them to keep the world in a spirit of holiness. You and I are here to create a world of holiness, not violence, not war, not confrontation, not continuously being in a state of fear and doubt and insecurity, not knowing what the next day is going to bring, but we're here to create a world of holiness. And that can only be acquired in our pursuit to continue to study and to understand these cycles of life. Excuse me for a second. So this is very, very important. We've got to study. We've got to study. We don't go into these cycles accepting the same experience that we engaged last year. We've got to study, we've got to meditate, we've got to reflect and engage these cycles to understand the higher spiritual essence of what these cycles are bringing to us. In doing so, as the Father wrote, this spirit produces holy thoughts, holy sacred thinking patterns, holy thoughts which form the ideas that produce actions. Holy thoughts produce holy actions. Holy thoughts produce holy behavior with my wife, with my children, with my brother, with my sister, with the stranger by the way. Holy thoughts bring peace and stability into my environment. This is very, very important. These holy thoughts produce holy actions that produce holy behavior, that create peace, harmony, and stability. This is very important for us to understand. So our entry into the new year, our entry into the Rosh Hashanah, will bring more holy thoughts that will produce more holy behavior that will create a more holy environment. Very important for us to understand. And as he continues to write here in God, the Black Man and Truth, again, pages 186 and 87, he said, after man returns into the divine and holy cycles of life, he will immediately be transformed. Rosh Hashanah, the new year, the first month of the year of the creates and causes transformation, to be born again. To be born again in his manner of thinking and doing. Your Yahuwah's righteous cycles are designed to change man's sense of values, giving him a new spirit and feeling of oneness, a feeling of being a part of something and someone. That's what this is all about. We want to pass over into a higher state of consciousness, into a higher state of understanding of what is required to live, a higher state of understanding our wholeness, our holistic connection with all of creation and one another, creating a higher sense of oneness. Oneness. I value my life. I don't recklessly live. I value my life. And because you and I, we value our lives, we control how we think. And we control who influences our thinking. Who is it that we're listening to? Who is it that we are looking at? Who is it that is causing us to feel the way we feel? This is vitally important because all of these factors influence how we experience this life that we are privileged and blessed to live. So I value my life. You value your life. And because you value the precious breath of life that is in your soul, you think about what you're doing. You just don't eat anything. You just don't drink anything. You just don't say anything. You just don't do anything that you just want to do. You think about the things you eat, the things you drink, the things you say, the things you do, and you ask yourself whether or not these things that I am doing are enhancing and creating a greater value in me for my life. This is highly important. This is what the spirit of the Passover and the spirit of our entry into the new year is all about, to create greater value of the principles of life for my life. And if I love myself, then I must love my neighbor. I will love my neighbor as I love myself. As I rise in consciousness of the cycles of life and the principles of life, I will relate to my wife, I will relate to my children, I will relate to my neighbor, I will relate to my fellow human being and the stranger, by the way, with a greater sense of value, because I love my neighbor as I love myself. I seek to do unto others as I do unto myself. And when I understand that my greater self is the magnificence of the presence of your Yahuwah in me, then I govern myself in accordance with that. I rise in my Godship. I rise in my godly understanding of what is required of me to live and to express love and life to others, to assist them on their journey so that they too can rise in the understanding of the principles of life. Very important. Very vital. This is not just some casual experience that you and I are privileged to live. So the Holy Father goes on. As man moves into this step-by-step, day by day, cycles for growth, he will see life as a part of him, having definite meaning and purpose. Who is it amongst you that doesn't want to live a life that has meaning? Who is it amongst you that doesn't want to live a life that has purpose. You're here for a reason. You're not just going by and experiencing life in a routine, ritualistic manner. Your life has purpose. Your life has meaning. You are an expression of the Creator of all of creation. And the more we rise, the more we ascend, the more we evolve in this understanding of why we are here, we will find ourselves becoming more disciplined in what we think, how we think, and how we behave. We will become more disciplined in what we allow to come out of our mouths. We just won't say anything, just flying off at the mouth, just being reckless and just saying anything to anybody because, well, that's just the way I feel. No, because I understand that the way I feel is very important and how I cause someone else to feel, then I will think about what I say. I will think about what I say because I understand that the things I feel are an expression of the life that I am living that is founded on principles that give my life purpose and meaning. And I don't want to defer from that. I don't want to defer or distract or turn away from the sacred principles that give my life meaning and purpose in this experience. This is very important for us to understand. We are those who are given the privilege to live a life of purpose, meaning, and holy and sacred value. Very important for us to recognize and to live our lives daily with that understanding. And again, going back to the excerpt, he reads on, I'm going to just repeat this, as man moves into his step-by-step, day-by-day cycles for growth, he will see life as having, as a part of him, having definite meaning and purpose. Yet, he will seek it being simple and not complicated. He will quickly learn the values of love and understanding by living them daily in oneness with others. You see, the kingdom of heaven can't be complicated. Now, certainly, Yahweh didn't create us, breathe the breath of life into us, cause us to be born from our mother's womb, only to live a life of torment, to live a life where you don't know what's going to happen from one day to the next. You're filled with fear and insecurity. You don't know what's going to go on tomorrow. What kind of God would bring his creation in such an environment? That's not what our God has created for us. Now, we may create it by the things that we allow to influence us and by the behavior that we display. We may create certain consequences that causes us to be fearful, doubtful, insecure, and uncertain. We create that. But the God of the heavens and the earth, the God that has created the greatest galaxies and the greatest stars, yet to have created the smallest atoms in creation, didn't bring us forth into this life to live a life of dreaded fear. Heavens, no. Heavens, no. That's not why we're here, and it's not complicated. He didn't make it rocket science that would be difficult to learn. He didn't make it something bizarre that would only be able to be learned by a few. It's for all of us. It's for all of the human family. But it's important that the human family be able to look upon living examples. Just like when you turn on the television, you see examples of people living a particular lifestyle and life pattern. Some of you are influenced by that, and you choose to display those lifestyles and life patterns in your own personal life. And because of that, you reap certain consequences. there are those who want to live the lifestyle of a gangster. They reap the consequence of a gang lifestyle. And then for those of us who desire to live a lifestyle that will bring peace and harmony and balance and stability and joy and holiness into our experience, we refer back to these sacred cycles that will allow us to experience that, to allow us to live it. It's not like we have to go into the high mountains of the Himalayas or into the remote region of the Pacific Ocean. It's right here. It's right here. We were born with this gift, and it's important for you and I to go within and allow the teachings and the guidance that will assist us to go within, to connect with the inherited presence of your Yahuwah that is right there vibrantly within our souls. Vibrantly. When you stop and you consider how when your parents came together and that sperm connected and that connected with the ovary, connected with that egg, and those cells begin to multiply. The synchronicity of the multiplication of those cells, how each atom, each molecule, each cell knew exactly where to go to create the you that you are. That is an expression of the mind of your creative source that is embedded in you. You are an expression. You are a representative. You are the image and the likeness of your creative source, your Yahuwah. And it's vitally important for you to recognize this, so much so that when you understand it, you will seek to express it and to display it in everything that you do. You're not just some average, everyday somebody. You and I are privileged to live a life that is filled with purpose and meaning in this experience, that has high, vital, significant value to be an example of divine living, holiness, sanctity for the lives of others. Very important, and I hope you can understand, all of this is vitally tied into the Passover. Because if you don't understand what is being said to you, you will not pass over into the next season with a greater sense of awareness of who you are. We want to pass over into a higher realm of consciousness, of awareness of what is required of us to live. We're not just taking the blood of the lamb and putting it on the doorpost and eating unleavened bread. We understand the higher principles of these actions and how they will affect us. So this is important. Everything that is being expressed to you this evening is vital to your life and to your welfare. And in closing from this particular excerpt of Ben-Ami, the writing, God, the Black Man, and Truth, he wrote, "He will see that the beauty of brotherhood is better than living in competition and hostility." Selah. You see, brothers and sisters, you and I have been born in a very special era of time. You and I have been born in an era where we are learning the principles of genuine life-giving peace. To have peace in your heart, to have peace in your soul, to understand what it means when we say Shalom Aleichem, or Shalom Alecha, Shalom Aleich. Peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Those are not small words. And we recognize, certainly, yes, I want to say peace be unto you, because I understand the principle. What goes around comes around. So if I'm expressing words and if I am displaying behavior that convey peace, that convey love, that convey life, it's like me making an investment. every word of peace, every behavior of peace, every display of peace, I'm investing in my own life. I'm investing in my own life. And one thing that we know about investments, you want returns. You want returns for the investment that you have made. What greater return would you desire to experience in your life to be able to know that more peace is coming your way, that more love is coming your way, that more joy is coming your way, that more stability is returning to you? Well, how do you know? Well, it's because that's what you express. That's what you transmit. That's what you display. That's what you share. You're not bringing hostility. You're not bringing anger, reckless anger. You're not bringing war. You and I are souls that bring forth peace, joy, happiness, oneness, love, energy, invigoration, value, higher principles that allow us to experience more stability, that extends, that literally immortalizes our presence in this journey. These are the vital things that we're learning to understand. We're not here to compete with anybody. We're not here to fight with anybody. You know, we don't have to try to, you know, feel like we're in some kind of competition. I just want to live and to enlarge and enhance the presence of the living energy of my creative source in me. Well, how do I do that? I want to learn. Well, how do I learn? I got to study. Well, what do I study? I want to study those things that help me to understand these principles that will give my life more meaning and purpose for me. This is what the Passover is all about. So if you take time and you go into the book of Exodus, the 12th chapter, you will see clearly the instructions that were given unto the ancients in the days of Moses, and all that was instructed unto him as to how, to guide the house of Israel in celebrating, recognizing, and, displaying this holy and sacred cycle. Okay. 12th chapter. We'll start at the first verse. And Yahuwah spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, again, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto the congregation of Israel, saying, in the tenth day of this month they shall take them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. For us in Jerusalem, we, in the early stages of our development, while we were there westward in Eden, in the state of Liberia, we initially, certainly as Hebrews, according to Hebraic tradition, as it's written here, we would take the lamb on the 10th day of the first month of the year and offer it up as an offering. However, when we were there in Liberia seeking to uphold this particular tradition, as it's written here, we had a magnificent experience. As we went and purchased a lamb of the first year, and we took the lamb and we tied it to a tree so that it would not be able to eat, and it would be able to cleanse itself in preparation for being able to be offered, you know, allowing the waste to be passed out of it. So, you know, again, we'd set the lamb to the side. And so when it was time to take this baby lamb of the first year and to prepare it for the offering, when we went to get it, we found that the lamb had hung itself. It had literally strangled itself by the rope that had it tied to the tree. And we were distraught. Oh, my goodness, what are we going to do? The very lamb that we had gotten in preparation to offer to Yahuwah, and to take the blood of the lamb to put it on our tents and everything, following the tradition as it's documented here in the book of Exodus, that very lamb was gone. And we were really in dismay, trying to figure out, my goodness, what are we going to do? The very lamb that we had set aside is now God. That experience caused us to realize that we were not to offer up the poor little lamb. We were not to take of its blood and kill it and take of its blood and put it upon the entries into our tents, etc. We began to understand, again, a higher principle of life. That the lamb, in essence, is a spiritual element. The lamb, the blood of the lamb, in representation of truth, in representation of the word of truth, the word of your Yahuwah, the principles that enhance our understanding of the cycles of life. And it's the principles of truth, the blood, the principles of life, the principles of truth, the word of your Yahuwah is to be placed on the doorpost of our minds, upon the doorpost of our hearts, to help us to understand these life-giving cycles, these life-giving principles. So we're not no longer going out every year in the first month of the year, in the first month of Aviv, and going and finding a little lamb, a humble little lamb, to kill it and to take of its blood. We're not doing that any longer. We understand, you know, Yahuwah never really wanted us to offer up sacrifices as such. These were things that our fathers learned while yet in the captivity in the days of our bondage in Egypt. These are things that the ancients learned from the nations and the peoples that were around them. But in our era of time, in our elevated state of awareness and consciousness, we recognize that all life is precious. So now we're not going out picking the lamb and killing it. We want these principles to be in our homes. We want this word of life, this truth, to be in our homes. And we seek to place it in the forefront of our minds through our study of it. And the more we study truth, the more we study the words and the principles of life, the word of your Yahuwah, then the presence of your Yahuwah is enlarged. It is magnified in us, in the homes of our fathers, in the homes of our families. And each family grows according to their pursuit of study and understanding of these principles. That's exactly what's being said. That's the eternal idea for us to recognize that in the 10th day of the month, we shall take this truth according to the principles that were given unto our fathers. And this truth would be for our house. It would be for our home. It would come forth and stabilize our home. It will allow the house that we live in to become a home of stability and understanding and peace. So again, the fourth verse, if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Again, we're not going to eat a lamb. That's what the ancients did. But we want to eat this truth. We want to consume this word. We want to be inspired and invigorated with this understanding that will enhance our lives, that will cause us to enter and to engage and experience a greater sense of oneness, holiness, and sanctity in our relationships with our Creator and one another. Yes, these are things that we will pursue to do, and these are the things that we pursue to do here at Jerusalem in this day. It is in this manner that we apply these laws, these instructions that were given unto the house of Israel in ancient of times. We now have evolved into the eternal idea of what these principles represent and how they are to be applied. So no, we no longer, after that experience there in Liberia and that little lamb hung itself, we understood from that day no longer were we to offer up the lamb as a sacrifice. We recognize that the lamb is representative of the true and living word of your Yahuwah, and it is that word, that life-giving truth, that we consume to enhance our lives. And as it goes on, okay, your lamb shall be without blemish, is the fifth verse, a male of the first year, you shall take it, and from out of the sheep, or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. Okay, again, I explained all of that. We're no longer doing that. And you shall take of the blood and strike it on the two sides of the post and on the upper door of the post of the house wherein ye shall eat it. And they shall eat it, they shall eat the flesh that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Now, let us get an understanding of what is being expressed here. This is very important. The night of the Passover, the night of Yom Yahuwah's Passover, is a night where, again, after coming into the month of Aviv, on the first day of Aviv, as we go into the sacred cycle of the new year, you know, I mean, it's like as we are approaching this new year, we should be excited. We should be just excited, just filled with excitement, knowing that we now are about to be catapulted, lifted up, and exalted into a higher realm of understanding, a higher realm of consciousness, of awareness, of what is required of us to magnify our lives and to magnify our ability to express the presence of your Yahuwah in creation. We should be inspired and invigorated, just filled with excitement to know that as I go into this new year, I will learn more. I will understand more because I recognize I'm not the same man that I was last year. I have changed in truth. I have grown in my understanding. I have evolved in my consciousness of what is required of me to live. This is what you and I must recognize. You and I must feel this. So as we enter into the night of the Lord's Passover and we are consuming this truth and we're sitting there, you know, we're there with our holy day meal, and we're sharing and we're engaging in discussion and conversation of the greater things that help us to understand, things that we learned in the last year that will assist us in our growth and evolution in this year to come. We are inspired. We are enlivened. And we are lifted up. We are lifted up. And so we, again, we're there and we're eating the unleavened bread. Unleavened bread, because this is bread that was made with haste. And it was made without the sourdough, the leavening, that old sourdough that is put in a loaf that causes it to rise. You know, we understand leavening to be that energy, that feeling that causes you to sometimes exaggerate situations. You know, somebody says something to you and they tick you off, and then you exaggerate your expression of anger. Or somebody says something to you, somebody said something to you last year, and you still holding on to it a year afterwards because you have exaggerated the situation. You didn't follow the African principle of going to your brother before the setting of the sun and resolving whatever your misunderstanding was. You just carry this anger. You carry this resentment. You carry this bitterness day in and day out. That's leavening. That is leavening. That is feelings. Those are feelings that a soul carries with them. It's that old baggage, that old sour, dead dough that weighs a soul down. It takes away from your energy to express life because you're carrying bitterness and resentment in your heart towards your brother and sister. Get rid of the leavening. The unleavened bread is your recognizing, I got to get rid of the leavening. I want to get rid of the kamatz, that sour dough, that old sour, bitter feeling that I've been carrying with me for days, for weeks, for months, that is literally killing me inside. I want to get rid of that. I don't want to go into this new year carrying leavening. I don't want to go into this new year filled with kamatz, filled with bitterness, filled with resentment, filled with anger. I dare not go into this new year with those kind of feelings. I want to evolve into a higher state of understanding, of principles that will help me to recognize the life that I am living that is filled with great purpose and meaning. This is very important. That's what the unleavened bread is recognizing, or is a similitude of. That's what it's symbolic of, to cast out those old, ugly, bitter resentments, you know, and just strife and anger. Let it go. Resolve your differences. Come ye, let us sit together, let us reason as men, as women, and let us create an understanding so that we can be in harmony with each other. And by doing so, we are then in harmony with our Creator, Yah Yahuwah. So the unleavened bread, the bitter herb, so that we can, you know, remember what we suffered, remember what we went through. Remember that there are things that we never want to go through again, that we just want to let go of, and we want to cast away from us, cast away from our experiences, never to have to live them over again. Here in Israel, we eat the matzah, the matzah, and it comes from the Hebrew word limtso. Limtso means to strain, press, extract, drain off. We want to extract the leavening. We want to drain off the leavening. We want to squeeze it out of us so that we can leave soak, so that we can pass over. Leave soak is the infinitive of the word pesach. Leap soak, to pass over, to leap, to jump to a higher level of understanding. But you can't do that if you're weighed down by kamatz. You can't do that if you're weighed down by leavening. We've got to cast that weight away. We got to let it go so that we can live and experience the beauty of this wonderful life that you and I are privileged and blessed to live. All of these things, if we can understand, if we humble ourselves genuinely to take time to identify with the beauty of these life-giving cycles, with the beauty of the new year, with the beauty of the coming of the Passover and the feast of unleavened bread, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, a whole week of preparation as we go into this new year of making sure that we don't have no leavening whatsoever. We know that, like here in Israel, there are Jews here, and there are probably even Hebrews there, that go throughout their homes, they go in their cabinets, and they're casting out those things that they identify as being leavening. And they're very meticulous about it. Then how much more meticulous should we be in searching our hearts to identify those leavened feelings, those leavened thoughts, and casting them out, getting rid of them, letting them go, letting go of that old luggage, baggage that some of you and some of us have been carrying for years. Let it go so that you can rise, you can be lifted in your understanding of the very truth that is essential for your life. You see, brothers and sisters, the beauty of this is that these sacred cycles that the Holy One of Israel has given unto us, from the Hebraic New Year to Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the counting of the Omer leading up to the Feast of Weeks, all of this takes place in the beautiful cycle of time that we call the spring equinox. The spring, again, life. But then if you look at equinox in Hebrew, the word equinox is hishtabut. Hishtabut. Equinox. I really don't care for using that. I'm just saying that it's a Greek term. But in Hebrew, these sacred cycles take place in the season of the hishtabut. Hishtabut, which is translated as a time period to become balance, for a time period of settlement, coming to terms, to experience harmony. That's what these cycles are established in. From Rosh Hashanah to the Feast of Weeks, these sacred holy days are established in the time period to engage balance and harmony, to bring that more to the forefront of your life. And then if we go to the seventh month of the Hebrew calendar, you know, Shabbaton Zikron Thur are those who identify it as being the blowing of the trumpets, the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot takes place during the fall Hishtabut. The fall Hishtabut, the time period again for harmony, balance, coming to terms. These things are to give us life. These experiences that have been placed in us as a part of our lifestyle are in place to give us life. But it's hard to experience this new life evolution and elevation if you're holding on to that leavening. If you're holding on to fear, exaggerated fear, exaggerated insecurities, if you're holding on and you're just carrying things that you've been holding on to for years, let it go. Let it go. Know ye the truth. Know ye the word of your Yehovah. Study and enhance your understanding of the principles of your Yehovah, and allow them to set your soul free. This is the season of liberation. To be liberated, to be freed of all of those things that have been weighing us down, to be free of all of those things that have been causing a spiritual illness and sickness that evolves into physical illness and sickness. Let it go. Let it go, and allow the word of your, the breath of life, to flow through your soul and live. This is the eternal idea of the Hebraic New Year, of the Feast of Passover, and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. all of these things, when you understand them, magnify the very elements of our being, the earth, the wind, the fire, the water of our essence. They give us more purpose and meaning in this life. They cause us to draw closer together to our creative source, your Yahuwah, and one another. No longer are we sacrificing the lamb. We understand the lamb to be the word of your Yahuwah, truth. Those things that enhance life, that's the blood that we place on our hearts and on our minds. The word of truth, the word of life, the word of your Yahuwah governs us, guides us, directs us, and protects us in everything that we do. Hence, we become living examples of peace. So, brothers and sisters, I'm praying that what has been shared with you this evening has been understood. I wish I could look into your countenances and see you and be able to talk with you face to face. I just pray that this technology is able to convey to you the full essence and spirit of what is being expressed to you here from Jerusalem, here in the Holy Land of Israel, the land of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, here from the kingdom of Yah on earth. We pray that it is touching your hearts. We pray that it is invoking thoughts and feelings in your soul to cause you to reflect, to contemplate, and to consider the changes that each of us must make in our lives so that we can pass over into a new realm of awareness, consciousness, and what is required of us to live and to magnify the presence of your Yahuwah on this planet. In the name of our Holy Father, Ben Ami, and on behalf of the prophetic priesthood, every word that has been shared from my mouth has genuinely come from my heart, and I genuinely pray that it has touched yours. Selah. Toda Rama.
Toda, toda. Cohane, that was powerful. That was powerful. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of Yah from Jerusalem. Man, that was powerful, Cohane. I know the brothers have a bunch of questions to ask. We're going to open up the lines as well, have callers call in. So we hope that you can stand by and address your people. So any of the brothers have any questions for Cohane before I start?
Yes, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Can you further elucidate, just give us a more further understanding of the function of a priest within our community? What is it that the priesthood does? What constitutes a priest, just to give our audience some context to what they just heard and how important it is.
To be a priest is simply to be a servant. It's, again, I mean, it was even told unto Moses that, you know, we would be a nation of priests, a nation and a communal body of souls that understand the law, that understand the principles of truth and the cycles of life and how to live in accordance with them. All of us should be in pursuit of study, as was said to you earlier. All of us should be in a continual state of study and enhancing our understanding of the principles of life. That's each of our priestly duty. If you want to live, you got to understand the laws that govern life. You want to live, you got to understand the cycles that govern life. You want to live, you got to understand the truth that gives life. This is all very important. So a priest is one who serves and who understands and pursues to enhance his, her understanding of what is required to live. And through that study begins to be a living example, an expression of such, so that all would be able to look upon him or look upon her and understand, okay, these are the things that I can do, that I can express in my life, in experience in my life, that will enjoy me, that will allow me to live a life that is filled with more joy, more thankfulness, more appreciation, more fulfillment, more evolution. So a priest, in all essence, is a servant who seeks to magnify the presence of the law, the presence of the significance of the cycles, the experience and the expression of truth in one's life to allow them to continue to evolve and experience a greater beauty of what this life is all about. It's not complicated. It's not spooky. It's just you want to live. And because you want to live, you study and you pursue to higher, get a higher understanding of what is required to live, to be housed in these vessels. You know, I was thinking about the scripture, the flesh profits nothing. It's the spirit that gives life. When you begin to recognize, in truth, life is a beautiful journey, and that you begin to understand, truly, the spirit gives life, and the flesh gives presence to spirit. So, as a priest, we want to study and understand what is required of us to give our spirit greater presence. You don't want to live in a vessel. You know, you go out, you see an old raggedy car. You look at the car, you be like, oh, man, I don't want to be in that kind of vehicle. You want to get a car that's fresh. You want to get a car that's got that kind of zest to it and pizzazz. So these vessels that you and I are housed in are to continually reflect life. So I want to study and understand what is it that really governs this vessel to make it more of a vibrant presence of my spirit that I'm privileged to express at this time. So
hallelujah. Priest, I don't want to cut you off, but we do have a caller, and I want to encourage everyone. You can call in and speak to Rahvyah HaKohane, who is a member of the Prophetic Priesthood of Jerusalem, by calling in at 713-955-0707. So call in. Mori Yoel, are you on?
Can. Shalom, family. Can. Hallelujah. Giving all honor and praise to the Most High, Yahweh. And definitely, Cohane Rahvyah, I'm super impressed with what I've heard tonight. I mean, this is my area, my field right here. When we start talking about, you know, Rosh Hashanah and dealing with, you know, Ha'abib, dealing with Seor, dealing with Kamat and Matzah. So definitely it's good to hear the concept of a new year. And everything else around us renewing itself. The birds come around, you know, in certain parts of warm areas. The bears come out of hibernation. The sun comes out a little longer. You know, the grass comes up. The flowers come up. Everything is renewed. So this is a wonderful, wonderful time for us in our new year and our rebirth. I do have one question for you, Rahvyah.
Yes,
but
sir.
I'm gonna yield my question because we do have a caller, and I definitely want to get to our caller, and I definitely encourage everyone to call in. The number here is 713-995-0707. And real quick, I'm just going to divert straight to our caller. With the number, area code starting with, I'm sorry, with 202-386, your line is unmuted, and Cohane Rahvyah is standing by to listen or to answer whatever question you have for him.
Yeah, shalom. Give our praise to the Most High. That that knowledge was just so powerful. It was touching. It was evoking. It was all of it. My question is, if it was interesting the way you emphasized that we're supposed to jump and leap. And I was like, leap year? I wonder if that's where they got the leap year thing from, just taking a little bit of our culture. I just thought that was an interesting point. But I just wanted to say, Toda Rabah, for that, the way you brought forth the peace, it made me see it a whole different way, and it just makes sense. But the leap year piece, that just kind of struck out, like that must be where they got that from. But Toda.
Hallelujah, sister. Thank you so much, and peace be unto you eternally, and may your Yahuwah bless you eternally, and thank you for being a part of the audience this evening and listening in, and again praying that what has been shared with you will inspire you and encourage you to study and magnify your presence in this wonderful life for us all to be able to continue to enjoy. I don't know whether or not they may have taken that from us, to create what they identify with the 29th day of the second month of the Julian calendar as being a leap year, et cetera. I don't know. But what I do know is that for us, you know, again, the word Pesach comes from the Hebrew word lipsoach, which, as was said, is translated as to jump, to leap, you know, to ascend, to evolve. And to pass over into a higher state of consciousness, a higher state of awareness of this wonderful life that your Yahuwah has privileged you and I and all of us to live. So that much we do know. What they've done, how they've done, why they have done, I can't engage that. But I do know clearly what has been given unto you, what has been given unto I, to us, to understand about this sacred cycle. And if we engage it properly, we will find ourselves experiencing a beautiful, life-giving transformation. Selah.
Hallelujah. Sister, do you have any other questions for the Kohen? Okay. She probably clicked off. Mighty Hebrew, are you on?
Kane, I'm on Moray Kanaya.
We waiting, anticipating your response to this powerful
absolutely,
message.
Absolutely. All right, yes.
We waiting.
Yes. First and foremost, giving all praise and honor to Yah, the supreme, sovereign, eternal power of the multiverse in this universe. How you feeling today, Cohane?
I'm in heaven with you, my brother.
Absolutely. We definitely rising in love in heaven. You know, I did a lot of research on you, you know, about the prophetic priesthood. I would like to ask you a question. The marriage of the Lamb, we know that in the 99, going into 2000, we had the marriage of the Lamb, or the first marriage of the Lamb ceremony. And now we're going into another round right now. And I remember the Father talked about post-judgment at the same time. He wrote the book on the resurrection from judgment to post-judgment. Where does the prophetic priesthood stand in this dispensation of time going into 2017? And from the inception of the marriage of the Lamb back in 2000, what realm are we heading in right now? And how does that affect us, you know, via the prophetic priesthood, as well as connecting it to the Pesach, the Passover, as well, into the new realm that we're heading in this dispensation of time, since the Father transcended, you know what I mean, and ascended.
Okay. Well, certainly, since the transition of the Holy Father in the 12th month of 2014, all of us have been required to evolve in our understanding and in our responsibility as servants of the Most Holy. Everyone has to be more aware of his or her portion. And so for the prophetic priesthood, we now have a greater responsibility to remember how we have been taught, to remember how we have been led, and to take those teachings and take those principles and that guidance and utilize it on a daily basis to enhance our ability to serve and to be able to share what was given unto us so that all may understand what is required in this great season and time. Without any shadow of a doubt, I mean, the kingdom has grown and is growing. We continue to enhance our understanding of these principles and teachings that have been given unto us, and it causes us to all become more responsible of how we live and how we convey what we have been taught unto others so that you and I can have a clear view of what is required of us. So we just got to sharpen our tools. We got to become more astute. We got to become clearer in our ability and become more capable in our ability of conveying this truth. You know, you sometimes it's like you can be on a team and you have a star player, and maybe you get comfortable feeling that, you know, well, we know the star player is on the court and he's going to always hit his shot. But if all of a sudden the star player ain't there, then the bench got to deliver. We can't be just bench players. Just
absolutely.
Back watching. We got to get in the game. You and I got to get in the game.
Okay.
We got to get in the game. Get in the game. Get in this game of life. Get into
absolutely.
It with all of your heart, soul, and might. You're not to sit back. You're not a spectator. This is not a spectator experience.
Mm.
Get in the game. Get involved with it with all of your heart, soul, and might, because it determines the life you will live. So that's what's upon the priesthood. That's what's upon every soul who desires to be a part of this experience. Get into the game. Don't just sit back waiting for somebody to come and give you some instructions on it. You know, get in the game. Get the ball. You feel good about the fact you know how to make a shot, or you know how to deliver the pass. You know how to carry and handle the pressure. Get in the game.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
That's what we're trying to do, Cohane. We're trying to get into the game. I mean, he sums it up. Hallelujah. Moriel, you still there?
Can. I need Poe. I'm really sucking in everything that Cohane Rahvyah is saying. And I enjoyed the question that the Mighty Hebrew just asked him as well. And the response was right on point. My question to you, Cohane Rahvyah, and I definitely enjoyed the lecture and the understanding and breakdown of Rosh Hashanah, as well as the concept of us gravitating to renewing ourselves as well, because we are one with the land. We are supposed to be in tune with the earth. So my question to you is, what are some steps around this time period, you know, some more detailed steps that you would think that people, you would suggest people to take in preparation of, you know, maybe cleaning the homes themselves, whatever the case may be. What advice or suggestions would you give, Cohane?
Well, my brother, again, peace be unto you, and thank you so much for being a part of the listening audience as well. The first step is with self. You know, stop, introspect, retrospect, reflect, and contemplate your life. The life you've lived, the life you've experienced that has brought you to this point. And as you look at yourself in the mirror, as you look at yourself in your reflection, consider the changes that you got to make with you. Not so much looking at somebody else and talking about how they need to change, but looking at yourself and identifying the changes that you need to make. These are the steps that each of us should take at this stage in our life as we prepare to go into this Hebraic New Year. Each soul should stop and consider what things I need to do to make my life better, What things that I need to do that will invigorate my health, that will give me greater performance capacity. You know, maybe, you know, you would hear in times, you know, people would always talk about New Year resolutions. You know, well, what are your New Year resolutions? What are things that you're looking at that you're resolved to do that will cause your life to move forward? And only you can describe that. Only you know. You know. You know. You know what you've experienced. You know what you've gone through. You know what you're feeling right at this moment. You know. And no one else knows like you. So as you look at you and as you engage you and as you reflect on your experiences and the things that you have lived, think about the things you need to change about your health, about the manner in your relationships, the things that you eat, the things you drink, you know, how you behave and carry and govern yourself, your environment. Is your environment a reflection of who you really are? You know, all these things are very important. The Holy Father taught us access to the proper knowledge is the prelude to the power to change your thoughts and transform your environment. So as you continue to pursue this proper knowledge, you're going to begin to see your thinking processes will change. As your thinking processes change, your whole perception, interpretation, and response to events change. Hence, bringing unto you a whole nother world of responses or results or consequences. You know, they're good consequences to be lived as well. Many people, when they hear the word consequence, they think of it as a negative term. But they're good consequences. And it's based on you accessing that proper knowledge, accessing that truth, and applying that truth, living that truth, that will allow you to transform and change and evolve in your life. So I would simply say to everyone to stop and take a good look at oneself and consider, contemplate, retrospect, introspect, and reflect on your life and consider the changes that you need to make to cause you to move forward and evolve in your life experience.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Todah Cohane, that was a wonderful response. I have one more question for you. If I hope I'm not, brothers don't mind me asking one more real quick. Related to the word, Cohane, say or, because during the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Kagamatsu, we are commanded to get rid of the Seor as well as the Kametz. And so one of the root words for Kametz or Kamat is that which is aggravating, that which is like left over. So how would you relate that, Cohane, with our lives, our spirit, our daily lives, not just Seor or Kamats as in the literal ingredient of food, but more so introspect of an individual's life in general?
Well, I mean, just as was stated earlier in the presentation this evening, again, who wants to live a life of aggravation? To go through your journey filled with aggravation, you know, to be filled with discomfort, to be diseased, to be at a state of dis-ease about your experience cannot be a good thing at all. And that's why it's important, going back to your first question, as one looks upon oneself, to consider, again, what goes around comes around. What am I doing that is causing aggravation to come into my life? What am I saying? How am I behaving to cause discomfort to come into my life where I'm surrounded by things that cause me to be at a state of dis-ease? It's all reflective. Everything in our experience is reflective of where we are in our mind. It's all reflective of where we are in our hearts. Our experiences and our relationships with our wives or our wife, our experience and our relationships with our children, with the managers on the jobs, with the brother up the street, with the sister up the street. It's all a reflection of something that is inside of me. So I've got to consider, you know, what is it that I'm doing that is bringing the kamatz into my experience, to bring that discomfort into my experience. And if I really allow myself to be genuinely truthful with myself, I will be able to clearly identify whatever that behavior is and something that I'm saying and something that I'm doing that is causing that discomfort. Again, these things have spiritual, daily life significance. It's not just dealing with a food substance. It's dealing with our everyday life journey. And we've got to contemplate, each of us, in our own way, based on the life we have lived, have got to look at ourselves and consider, what is it that I have to do to remove that particular experience from my life? First, I got to remove it from me. Remove it from me. It's not just me getting up and separating myself from the person or the situation. No, that's a step. But the main thing is that I don't want it to come back again. So I got to make sure it's out of me. It's got to be that aggravation, that kamatz, that energy, that negative energy that continually causes me to go through certain negative experiences. I got to let it go. I got to liberate. This is the season of liberation. I got to liberate myself from that. Again, know ye the truth about yourself, and the truth will set you free from your aggravation. Selah.
Hallelujah. Soda, go ahead. Gang.
Go ahead, Maury. I'm sorry.
Gang, definitely appreciate that. And it makes so much sense to align ourselves with the season. So, Cohane, what you're basically saying is that it's no coincidence that as a people around this season, we call it spring cleaning, right? So that's not a coincidence.
Yes.
That around this time, we as a people are getting ourselves together.
That's it. Spring cleaning. Let us be thorough.
Okay,
I love it. Yeah, that's the whole point. I like that.
I have to say, this was a very profound presentation. I think what you were able to do with the listening audience is you did exactly what the title said. You took the ritual and you made it much more plain. You took the spookiness out of it. The death angel and the blood and the killing of a lamb.
Absolutely.
All those things.
That's
if
right.
You tell a child that, you know, it might sound like a spooky story, you know. You took all of that spookiness out of the ritual and you made it plain and you got to what we all have to, we got to get to the eternal idea. What is the significance of all of those rituals? A lot of us find ourselves, especially other Hebrews and people in other faiths, we stick so much to tradition and ritual and we never learn what the real eternal idea and the essence of what the Creator is trying to communicate with us. So I think this was a profound lesson. I mean, I learned something, and I've heard these classes over and over again for years, but I learned something again tonight. And we always going to continue to learn something as we evolve or we jump.
Yeah.
So it was a profound lesson. I'm gonna pass it on. Then I want to kind of close it out with some few questions that I have. But I want the brothers, like the Mighty Hebrew and the Ben Kael, to come on and ask the priest questions before I close it out.
Okay. Hey, Shalom.
Okay, go. No, my fault. Go ahead, Ben Kael. I'll wait.
Okay. Just give you just a second here. And I wanted to say to Moray Yoel, this is the brother that I was telling you about that you reminded me of. Y'all were laughing for a second there, and I could not tell y'all apart. The resonance in voice and the spiritual inclination, y'all are related.
I can see that, man. Hallelujah.
So to tie everything in, I just wanted your thoughts, Cohane, on a passage from the Impregnable People that really connects with your message this evening. The message that was transmitted through you to us, rather. And this means a lot to me personally, you know, just within being within the redemption struggle about 19 years and, you know, in purging self, going through ups and downs, and you really have to make decisions on your perspective on your experience. Are you going to be bitter or better? And so this really hit me. I was meditating upon this earlier this week and touched upon it. It's from the Impregnable People. This is actually a autobiography of sorts of Prince Gabriel Hagadol for the listening audience, who was basically the right-hand man of His Excellency Ben Ami before he was exposed to the truth, during, and through this whole journey, and was also my very esteemed next-door neighbor. In the Kafar. So,
that's beautiful.
Let me read the end of this is at the very end. This is after the lamb had hung himself in Liberia.
Okay.
It reads on this wise. Ben-Ami was away in Monrovia at the time of the incident. Upon his return, he was immediately informed of the death of the lamb. Neither his posture nor his countenance changed. He simply said, Zebeseder, it's all right. At first, we were bewildered by the cool manner in which he had received this shocking and disturbing news. We soon thoroughly understood, however, for Ben-Ami delivered a Passover message so powerful that it erased the thought of killing and sacrificing lambs or any other creature for our minds forever. Simply, thoroughly, and in a manner in which a fool could not err, he taught us that we, the entire congregation of the Hebrew Israelites, had become as the Lamb. In a class entitled The True Sacrifice, he explained that sacrificial offerings, because of the great decline and fall of man, had become mere allegorical vanity. The slaughter of an animal was simply a symbolic and ritualistic tradition. With the return of the true worship of Yah, the offering of scapegoats would be rendered obsolete, null and void.
Right.
The true sacrifice was, in effect, our righteous efforts and deeds, hardships and suffering on the path that led unto our God. We thusly had symbolically become the Lamb. We had become the spiritual sacrifice.
Beautiful.
Could you elaborate on that for us, please?
I'm sorry. What was your last statement?
I said, could you elaborate on that for us, please? Share your thoughts.
As you read, the words are self-explanatory, and that's exactly what occurred in that experience there in Liberia. And as was stated, yes, you and I are the Lamb. You and I are those that are to make the sacrifice change that is required to evolve, to no longer just accept the way things are and the way that some things have been imbued in us from the time of our childhood, maybe by parents, by environment, and situations. But now to engage life with a greater sense of vigor and determination to know what is required of us, that takes sacrifice. That takes not just being comfortable with everyday explanations or what comes on the news as being what's in the know. You know, you are walking the unbeaten path. You're walking a path that not has been treaded by a lot of people. And you're on a uncharted journey. It's not
written and documented like that, what's going to happen every day. I mean, we do have the prophetic guidance and direction, but when it comes to the day-to-day details, there are things that we're learning along the way. And the beautiful thing about the changes that you and I are making as we offer ourselves up as the Lamb, as those who desire to genuinely be nurtured, cultivated, and guided by this truth, is that we receive clarity of the change that each of us must make personally. And as we do that, and you, it may sound repetitive, but as you and I make our own personal, intimate changes, we find that our experience and the journey becomes much easier. It becomes much easier. And the clarity, the understanding becomes much clearer. And we find ourselves really just being inspired because you see like you've never seen before. See, the sacrifice that we're making is we sacrifice that aggravated energy, as we sacrifice that exaggerated, fearful energy, as we let go of that and we draw nigh and closer in oneness and harmony with your Yahuwah and with one another, we find ourselves being strengthened like never before. To sacrifice that which was insignificant so that we can accept what is significant is empowering. We're finding ourselves being empowered, being strengthened and fortified like never before. So all of these things, yes, it just makes sense. We let go of the Lamb, and we identified ourselves as being the Lamb. As was said earlier, we identify the word of your Yahuwah being the Lamb. You know, that's what we're consuming. As we consume this truth and we begin to expel and dispel the lie and the deception, we find ourselves being empowered and fortified like never before. Beautiful, beautiful illustration. I love the way the Prince wrote that.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to encourage you, listening audience, if you want to call in and speak to Cohane Rahvyah, you can call in at 713-955-0707. So if you have any questions for the priest, please call in.
Okay.
Mighty Hebrew.
Absolutely. It's actually two questions. The first question is a rumor out there that there's going to be Impregnable People Part 2. Is it out? Did Prince Gabriel put it out yet, or is it in the process of being put out? And also, with the prophetic priesthood, could you give briefly a brief synopsis of how one gets, I'm just using the word for a lack of word, but initiated into the prophetic priesthood, if they would, you know, like to become a priest? Could you explain to the family how they can take the initiative steps to become a priest? Hallelujah.
Okay. Well, regarding the rumor, I would imagine that the author would give you a direct response to that, whether it's rumor or reality. I, too, had heard, but one thing I've learned about rumors, it's always best to go directly to the source and they can clarify everything about that. So if you get a chance, if you can reach out for the Prince and inquire of him regarding Impregnable People Part 2, I'm sure he'll give you a direct response on that. Regarding the second part of your question, to become a member of the prophetic priesthood, you can go online. We have a website, the Prophetic Priesthood at Jerusalem. You can also communicate with our secretary, Eliram HaKohen, by going into the Prophetic Priesthood at gmail.com. And you can submit your resume, name, who you are, where you are, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And information can be given to you insofar as the process and the steps that can be taken for entry into divine law classes, priesthood studies to help to cultivate, nurture those who desire to become members of the prophetic priesthood. And, you know, certainly we would be more than overjoyed to have those who desire to participate with us in this great service to the family of the House of Israel, you know, whatever and whomever it may be that desires genuinely in their hearts to partake of this great dynamic work. You know, we just don't turn our backs or turn those souls down if it's a genuine desire. Certainly everyone would be evaluated, and, you know, those requirements would be set into motion, and we'll do everything we can to assist those, to guide and direct and to help to inspire to enter into the family of the priesthood if that's what you desire to do.
Okay, Cohane, can you repeat that address again where they can actually get that information?
Prophetic priesthood, the prophetic, again, it's all one word, the prophetic priesthood, in small letters, the prophetic priesthood, @gmail.com.
Okay.
Okay, that's two.
Okay. How long is the
email
process?
The classes are, it's a 2-year class process.
Okay, I gotcha. I got a question, it's more at Kenanya. I want to know, how long have you been a priest? Give us a little background, the history of the prophetic priesthood. How did it come about? And what is the difference between the Levitical and the prophetic priesthood? You know, because we know that in the traditional Hebrew Israelite culture, the priests were the Levites. I wanted you to kind of touch on that a little bit. So basically kind of give us an overview or a history of how that came about, because you are one of the original prophetic priests, right? That's correct?
Yes, I've been a priest now for 36 years. The first initiates into the prophetic priesthood were Nasik Eliezer, the elder priest, and a brother by the name of Brother Elihu. They were the first ones, and along with the Holy Father, they began to set into motion priesthood studies back in about 1977, and the first graduates into the family of the prophetic priesthood, the first graduation took place in the ninth month, 1979. I personally graduated in the fifth month, 1980. The difference between the prophetic priesthood and the Levitical priesthood is that, in accordance with the prophecy, you know, Judah would return to the Holy Land. And we understand that with the diaspora, the dispersal of the House of Israel, you talk about the tribes. I mean, we were cast all over the place. And so as time continues to unfold, I'm sure all of us are certain that the tribal attributes of the members of the kingdom will begin to come forth. Right now, we are all a part of the tribe of Judah that was prophesied to return to the Holy Land and to initiate the initial stages and development of the kingdom of Yah on earth. And so hence, we are those who have come forth from the diaspora, returning back to the land. And because we give respect to Levi and the tribe of Levi, you know, we also give respect to the prophetic utterance and the requirement of the tribe of Judah to be the, you would say, the beachhead. You know, we get here first, and showing no disrespect or disregard to the Levitical element and historical backdrop, we've identified ourselves as the prophetic priesthood at this time. And as the seasons unfold and as we continue to evolve and develop as a kingdom, I'm sure that certainly more of the characteristics and spirit of the different tribal entities will be able to be seen, felt, and understood. And who knows? I mean, again, we may go back into the Levitical, the Aaronic, you know, priesthood bodies again. Right now, we call ourselves the prophetic priesthood in accordance with the prophetic utterance and statement that Judah would return, the tribe of Judah would return and be the beachhead and establish the foundation of the kingdom. And that's how that name came about, as the prophetic priesthood. And yes, we do give acknowledgement and respect to the ancient Levitical and Aaronic expression of Yahweh, of those brothers and family who were a part of the priesthood in ancient times.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Which gives me gets me to my comment. Being that I've been associated with the community almost 15 years now, and basically I've been back and forth living in Israel for almost about 10 years. One thing that I could say is that the prophetic priesthood are true servants in the community. You all do a lot of things, from the circumcisions to the weddings to the convocations. We were talking about how you can be initiated into a priesthood. People have to know what that what that job description is, because it can be pretty heavy. And so
yeah,
I wanted to know, how do you manage your workload as a priest? Because I know that you all do a lot in the community.
Sorry. Well, it's definitely an experience. I pray that soon those men who have desired to serve in the capacity of priest will one day be able to serve completely without having to divide time and energy to jobs and things of that nature just to sustain ourselves, to be on a job 9-10 hours a day, then to come in the evening and counsel, having to assist in engaging souls who are in need, and other aspects of this office can be a challenge. It can be. What the beauty of it is, what inspires us, is the rewards that come from divine servitude. The brothers who are a part of the prophetic priesthood, and even the sisters who are a part of the Lamdaniot, who assist us, are brothers and sisters who enjoy serving, who enjoy giving, who enjoy being there to assist and to help to contribute to the lives and welfare of others. And it's again, it goes back to what was being said earlier. I mean, it's a beautiful investment because you definitely get some wonderful returns. And that is what continues to inspire us to give all that we can to the best of our ability unto our God and to our people.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. That was
hallelujah.
Any other brothers have any comments? Because
hey,
we're going to close it out.
We're
not going to keep the priest up all night.
We got a call, you.
Oh, okay, go ahead. Let's take the call.
773 number.
Okay, we have a caller calling in. Air code 773-930. Your phone is unmuted, and Cohane Rahvyah is standing by to answer whatever question you may have for him.
Thank you. Shalom, shalom, mashalom, Kai. This is Brother Nebrakia. Shalom, Cohane Rahvyah. Been excellent information you've been giving so far. Mashalom, Kai, Cohane. Hello?
Go ahead.
Hey, shalom, go ahead.
Rocky, you still on the line?
Yeah, I'm still on. Can you hear me?
Yeah, he probably could hear you. Go ahead and ask a question. He made it jumped off. He'll jump back on.
Okay. Yeah, I was just actually watching the show a stream video earlier. I don't want to ask about the. Hello?
Go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I'm here.
Hey, Cohane, this is Rocky.
I'm sorry, I can hear you. Go ahead. I'm listening.
The Seder, Mashalom Kai. Excellent information and dispensed so far. But just cutting straight to it, I was watching a short stream earlier, and I just was listening to your speech. You was one of the priests that was out there. And I just, not going too deep, off the topic, I just wanted you to express, your memories and your feelings of that moment, because that was just a, prophetic moment, and strengthening of the priest, and, the faces, and the all white, and, it was a high point in the kingdom. So I just wanted to, the priest was on the front line, so just on tune on the, importance of the priesthood and the actions of the priesthood, like Amore tonight was speaking on, excuse me, I would just like for you to express, if you can, any memories of that moment.
Okay, which particular moment are you talking about, my brother? I didn't get
talking about the, he said the day of the show of strength.
Yeah, the 22nd day of the fourth month, 1986. Yeah, that's a memorable moment. It's indelibly embedded in my heart. It was a time of great fortitude of the kingdom, a time where we were ready to put it all on the line. We were not afraid. A time where, regardless of what was set before us, what was arrayed before us by those who were determined to do whatever they may have been planning to do that day, we were ready to engage fully to whatever extent would have been required to make it known to the inhabitants of this land, to the global body of the human family, to the universe, to all of creation, and to Yahweh directly, that we are serious about our desire to remain in this land and to do what is required of us to stay in this land. We've come here with a very holy and sacred intent to only do that which is good and right and that is pleasing in the eyes of the Holy One of Israel. And that is what has protected us. That is what has shielded us. That is what has guided and directed us all of these years, coming close to 50 years, that we have been privileged to allow the soles of our feet to walk upon this holy and sacred land. It's clear, distinctively clear, that there's definitely a greater force that has watched over us and that has protected us all of these years. We have been fortunate not to have suffered the things that brothers and sisters went through while yet there in the confines of the United States, members of the Black Panthers, SCLC, CORE, MOVE, SNCC, NOI, we have been very, very blessed, and it's very humbling that the Holy One of Israel has invested its spirit in us to protect us, guide and direct us all of these years. And definitely on that day, it was a clear display of the power and the presence of Yahweh in the midst of this humble body of people. Because it could have been a whole nother picture had that energy and that angelic presence not been in the midst of us. There's no doubt about that. But it was very humbling, and it caused us all to be very, very thankful for the glory and the holiness of the God of the house of Israel. And I just personally will never forget the feeling I had when you're looking at men who possess police batons and guns and horses and dogs, and you know, you have snipers on roofs and all of that. It could have been a very, very ugly situation. But as the Holy One of Israel would have it, none of that was able to occur. And from that day to this day, we've only improved in being able to further secure ourselves in this land and to continue in the building and the development of Yah's kingdom, so that all who desire to participate and to contribute to it and to be a part of it will be able to do so today and even in the days to come. So we've been very, very fortunate. Very, very fortunate. And we
Hallelujah.
Are very, very thankful.
And if any of the listening audience not clear about what the Day of the Show of Strength is, I'm going to post it on the VOZ Facebook page, Voice of Zion Facebook page. I believe that the video is on YouTube, and basically it was a confrontation between the community and the Israeli government back in the 80s where we were having issues with our relationship. So that was back in the 80s. And Cohane Rahvyah, you could see him in the video. He was one of the priests speaking. So it was a historical event in our history, the community. And Cohane Rahvyah is a historical figure. So just to give you guys a little background of what the Day of the Show of Strength is, again, I'll post it on the Facebook page, Voice of Zion. Brother, any questions? Any other questions for the Cohane?
Jane, I really enjoyed earlier when you were breaking down the concept of sacrificing the lamb. And it reminds me of one of my teachers, sort of my spiritual father, Nasi Kamul. He was one of the first teachers to come amongst us and to really break down that concept of not eating the lamb during Pesach. And so my question to you in reference to the lamb is how do we, I got the lecture earlier, and I got that you broke down the understanding of us, you know, we as a people being a sacrifice. But a lot of people really won't gravitate to that concept. So, like, how would we encourage people to have a open mind and understand the concept that the Creator never asked us for sacrifice? This is something that we wanted to do, so He gave us an order on how to do it. But sacrifice of the Most High has nothing to do with animals, but more so our attributes and things of that nature. So could you bring just a little bit more closure, clarity on that?
Okay. I'll certainly. In the book of Micah, are you there?
Okay.
Hello? Okay, you there.
Okay,
In the book of Micah, the sixth chapter, the book of Micah, the sixth chapter, and you can pick up verses 6, 7, and 8 of the sixth chapter of the book of Micah. All right? And it reads, okay. Wherewith shall I come before Yahweh and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will Yahweh be pleased with thousands of rams, or with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth Yahuwah require of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with Yahuwah, to walk humbly with thy God. That's what's required.
Wow.
The oil, the calves, the bulls, the turtle doves, the lambs, the goats. That's, he never really wanted that. Our Creator never wanted that. He wants us.
The Creator wants you. The Creator wants and you and I to realize that when we sacrifice what is needed to cause us to change, to draw closer in consciousness with the source of our being, that's all the Creator has ever wanted. That's all it has ever desired, to draw closer in our understanding and consciousness of who we are in representation of our Creator. And in sense, when we do that, we'll begin, as you see yourself as the true living image and likeness of your creative source, your Yahuwah, then you'll begin to understand, so is your fellow man. And you don't have to feel impatient or angry because others may not understand what you understand. Others may not see it the way you see it. The key is, as you continue to understand the essence and significance of who you are, and you live in accordance with that, your works will be seen. We're not here to coerce, force, and make anybody do anything. You're here to be a light. You're here to be an example. You're here to be a image for others to be able to look upon and to be inspired by. And it is through that example and that inspiration that you will genuinely affect their hearts and touch their souls.
Wow. That's powerful, Cohane. So is it safe to say, Cohane Rahvyah, is it safe to say that the appropriate or true sacrifice of Yahuwah have to do with giving life, not taking it?
There it is. You hit it right on the head. That's why you're here. You're a life giver. You are a life saver. You are a redeemer. You have come to revive, to breathe life into the souls of all men who desire to accept the life that you share. But you can't force them. You can't make them. You're not going to go to war with them. It's not, and think about it. All of these years of fighting and trying to coerce and trying to make and all the blood that was shed, it only got worse. Look at the history. Look at the history. All of those civilizations that were annihilated and that were destroyed for a quote-unquote righteous cause, nothing got better. But as you begin to understand and you begin to apply these principles in your life and you begin to live in accordance with that, you will find yourself being a more effective life giver, life saver, and redeemer than you ever were trying to walk around with a rod of iron trying to beat somebody into submission. It's just not going to work like that.
Wisdom.
You're not going to beat somebody into submission. When you look out, and please hear what is being said, hear it with your heart. Allow your ears of your heart to be open. With all of the pain and the suffering that man has experienced, Yahuwah has never ceased to give life. Yahuwah has never ceased to display its love, his concern and desire for man to change. That has never ceased. It has never stopped. That energy, the sun rises every day. The moon shines within its cycles. We go through the winter, spring, summer, fall experience every year. Flowers grow, trees grow, grass grow. It never, life never ceases. The problem, the only thing that has been ceasing has been us disconnecting from the processes and cycles of life. All we got to do is get in harmony with it, live in accordance with it, and watch how effective we will become by being an example of it. And that's just the truth.
And Torah,
not a lot of fanfare. Torah. Okay. sister.
Toda Rabba.
Lakasha. Lakasha.
Hakeem.
All right, Kanaya.
Well, yeah, I know it's getting to that time, Cohane. We're not going to keep you too long. The work of a priest in this community is extensive, family. So I can't keep my priest, who has a lot of work to do, up all night. But we appreciate you, Cohane. And I know over the years you've given great service to the community.
Yes, you have.
I remember.
Cohane.
I just want to reflect on some memories. I remember with my peer group, we started to get married. And let me tell you about Cohane Rahvyah. When Cohane Rahvyah said that he don't wait on someone to give him instruction, he's not that type of brother. He saw us, we was all getting married, especially everyone in my peer, and he saw us having issues. Now, Cohane Rahvyah took it upon himself, and I remember you walked up to me personally and said, get the brothers together, get your peer group together. I'm hearing certain things, I'm seeing certain things. You guys, I want to sit you guys down and teach you all about divine marriage. And Cohane Rahvyah came to our houses and met with us once a week for a season. You remember that, Cohane?
Yeah, and I remember.
And, man,
wow. Man,
he came and sat with us. And, I mean, it was just out of the goodness of his heart. It wasn't, you know, he just heard something, and he was like, well, I'm hearing something. And, if y'all having trouble, y'all need to get some counsel. Y'all young men, y'all just getting married, y'all just starting y'all families, y'all have to understand what the process is and understand what divine marriage is all about. And I remember you taking that time out with my peer group and doing that. I appreciate you, Cohane. Everything that you taught us, you know, I try to apply it, you know, and sometimes I may have fell short, but you know what? I still remember everything, and you know what? I'm still trying to apply those things today. So I appreciate you. I appreciate you on the show. This was an awesome class, just awesome. Timely. We're getting ready for Pesach. You really gave us a clear understanding of what this season is all about. So, Toda.
Well, Kananya, Mori Kananya, and to all the family. Is that someone else trying to come in?
No, go ahead, Cohane.
Okay, I was just saying to all of the family, all of those who have taken time out of your precious evening to listen in and to participate and just to allow the words that are flowing forth from Jerusalem to enter into your homes and into your hearts. Again, we're very humbled and we're very thankful for your participation in this particular session. And we're very thankful eternally unto your Yehovah for the breath of life that he continues to breathe into our souls. We're very thankful unto our Holy Father, Ben Eliazar, who was the vanguard, who was privileged to receive the vision and had the courage to stand for the vision that has allowed us to come to this land and to be a part and to participate in the building of this glorious kingdom. And to all of those near and far, whomever you may be, whatever it is that you do that contributes to life and that enhances life on this planet, we're very, very thankful for you all. And pray that Yah Yahuwah will continue to bless you all and keep you. Pray that Yah Yahuwah will continue to shine his face upon you and be gracious unto you. We eternally pray that Yah Yahuwah will continually lift up his countenance upon you all, guide you and direct you and protect you in this great life, give you greater understanding of the meaning and the purpose for your life. And in so doing, may Yah Yahuwah give your soul peace. So with that, brethren, family, Thank you all from Jerusalem. Selah.
Selah, Selah.
Selah.
Well, brothers and sisters, it's been another episode of the VOZ segment, the Voice of Zion segment on Do the Knowledge Radio. I want to thank my co-hosts, Mighty Hebrew, Mori Yoel, Akben Kael, Knowledge Born. We appreciate everyone, Basim, all of those who, Ak Rifael, who's up tonight, late night to 2, 3 in the morning. It's actually 4 in the morning, assisting us, making sure the Cohane came on and had the line to come on. So I appreciate everyone and making this happen. And anyone have any closing remarks, let's do it now.
Hey, this is Ben Kael one more time. I'd just like to thank you once again for your time, your patience, and your energy, Cohane. Very, very timely, as DeMore said. And you will be receiving my resume in person this season. I just wanted to reiterate before we got off of here for the listener audience, we were reading from The Impregnable People by Prince Gabriel Hagadol. Also, our beloved priest referenced God, the Black Man, and Truth by Ben Ami. You can purchase both of these at African Hebrew Israelites of Jerusalem.com, or you can search for it on Amazon. We prefer you get it straight from Communicators Press. And you can look at the event, the Day of Show of Strength, this historical event. You can put the Day of Show of Strength into your YouTube search bar or plug on in to the Voice of Zion Facebook group. And with that, shalom.
Shalom, shalom. So, shalom.
Gang, gang. Hallelujah. This the Mighty Hebrew, Cohane. I'm just grateful that you was able to come on and express yourself, you know, and express yourself with perfect perfection. And we learned a lot tonight, and I pray unto the Creator, Yahuwah Elohim, that he blesses you sevenfold and blesses all that is around you for righteousness' sake, and to continue the process and the journey of, you know, helping to awaken and establish this kingdom on earth. For you have a great task, and you have those that are coming, you know, forward in this dispensation of time to, you know, keep the vision that Adonenu Rabbeinu brought forth for us. And I'm just glad that the prophetic priesthood is here and that you're establishing, you know, that, you know, pronostication, you know, that was left on record via through Malachi, about, you know, gathering the sons of Aaron. And we know prophetically, you know, it's on a whole nother level now than what we knew as the Levitical priesthood. But again, it's just, you know, a great thing to know that there are brothers such as yourself that live to serve, you know, our people. And it gives me inspiration, you know, as to what I do, you know, by serving the people, and your inspiration to me, a role model, a mentor, and just an elder that I would love to, you know, yoke myself amongst. And I'm just glad that the Creator has preserved your life, and I pray that the Creator continues to preserve your life, and soon that we'll be able to meet. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Where
you at? Gang. Not going to be too redundant, but definitely wanted to give thanks to the Most High Yahweh, also to Cohane Rahvyah for the wonderful message. And Cohane, I just wanted to leave you with this this one verse which described your message tonight to us and to the family. The book of Malachi, the second chapter, verse 7, it says that the lips of the priest should keep knowledge, and they should accept the law at his feet, because he is a messenger of Yahweh of hosts. And so I definitely receive the law at your feet this evening, And we definitely received the instructions from your lips this evening as well. And very privileged and honored to be a recipient, as well as all those that were listening in, and I'm sure they felt the same way. So very blessed, and we pray the Most High will continue to be that priest that we can model ourselves after and look up to. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Okay, with that, Ben Kael, can you, Lord of Art?
Let's say that. Let's talk about Shuva Yahuwah, Revolt Alfe Yisrael. Hallelujah. 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 Yochai. 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 Yochai.
Hallelujah.
Sila. Hallelujah. Sila. Sila. Sila.
Laila Tolam. Again, this has been another episode of the VOZ segment on Do the Knowledge Radio. Tune in next Thursday. We'll have another dynamic presentation. We do it every Thursday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. And we have myself, Maury Kananya, Mighty Hebrew, Maury Yoel, and Ak Ben Kael are your hosts. So Torah for the listening audience. Tune in next week. Shalom, shalom.
Shalom, shalom. Lala
Tov.
Shalom, shalom. Shalom, hallelujah.